Please pray with me. Almighty God, we are so blessed to be a part of this ministry and this mission in Ecuador. What a wonderful opportunity for us to walk alongside these children and love them and care for them, pray for them, educate them, evangelize to them. Lord, we are your servants, and we appreciate this opportunity of this church to change lives for your kingdom through our work with the Hacienda of Hope. Lord, we come to you and we just ask for blessings on this ministry, Lord, that is something that you have laid on our heart to carry forward. We pray for each child that they will come to know you as their Lord and Savior, that we will be able to love them and educate them and prepare them to go out in Ecuador or any vocation or any country or any nation, Lord, and just change that community for you. Lord, I lift up our staff down there. We're so grateful that we have men and women that want to pour their lives into these children and to be there for them and walk alongside them and help them come to know you. Lord, just give them extra strength. Help us to be an encouragement to them. Lord, we ask for guidance and the vision that you have for this ministry in Ecuador. Lord, be with this church as we partner with that ministry. Lord, help us to know how we can help, what we can do, how we should pray, what resources we should send. Lord, we just beseech that knowledge. We ask you to give it to us. Lord, you have blessed us all in this room immeasurably. You've called us to be stewards of the resources that you give us. All that we have is yours. It's not ours. We ask that each member of this congregation pray this week about how they can contribute to this mission in Ecuador. Lord, increase our faith. Help us to realize, Lord, that you have all the resources at your disposal. Help us as stewards of those resources to give generously so that we can take care of these children in a way that you're calling us to. Thank you for your love for us. Thank you for your love for these children in Ecuador. Help us to continue to be your servants and care for them the way you're calling us to. In your son's name I pray, amen.
Would you consider these words from Jeremiah?
For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you hope and a future. Then you will call on me and come and pray to me, and I will listen to you. You will seek me and find me when you seek me with all your heart. I will be found by you, declares the Lord, and will bring you back from captivity. I will gather you from all the nations and places where I have banished you, declares the Lord, and will bring you back to the place from which I carried you into exile.
Let's take our offering.
You make beautiful things all the same. I wonder if I'll ever find my way. I wonder if my life could really change at home. All this earth, could all that is lost ever be found? Could a garden come?
You know, I never cease to be amazed at how God works. Several of the words that Daniel used in his prayer were similar to what I'm going to use right now. Our focus today is on the Hacienda of Hope in Ecuador, and the focus of the Hacienda is on children. The focus for them is the caring for the children, the teaching children about Jesus, teaching children how to live, and instructing them in the way of God. It seemed appropriate to start with a few verses of Scripture about Jesus and children. In Matthew 19:14, we read, "Then some children were brought to him that he might lay his hands on them and pray over them. And the disciples rebuked them. But Jesus said, 'Let the children alone. Do not hinder them from coming to me, for the kingdom of heaven is such as these.'" It's good to know that God wants children in his kingdom and that children make up a part of his kingdom. As parents, we want our children to know that they are part of a family. God wants all of us to know that we are part of his family. And we want all the children in the Hacienda to know that they are part of a family as well. In another verse that Lincoln talked about in the spring a couple of weeks ago, we read about how Jesus talks about how we are to be like children. Matthew 18:3-4, "Truly I say to you that unless you are converted and become like children, you will not enter the kingdom of heaven. Whoever then humbles himself as this child, he is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven." What does it mean to become like children? I think there are two ways we have to become like children. The first way is mentioned in the second part of the verse we just read. We have to humble ourselves as a child. Children don't think they know everything. They don't think they're the smartest person in the room. They don't think they're experts on any subject. They know that there are lots of adults that know way more than they know. I think this humility of children leads to the faith of children. I think the faith that children have is the second way we have to become like children. Children have total faith in their parents. They trust everything their parents do for them and the way they take care of them. This is the same faith that God wants us to have in him. But for some reason, as we grow older, our faith in God seems to shrink rather than to grow. I find myself relating very well to the father in Mark chapter 9 that Jody mentioned a few weeks ago. The man was describing his son's problem to Jesus, and he said to Jesus, "But if you're able to do anything, have compassion on us and help us." The response that Jesus gives seems so understated when you read the verse. He says, "If you're able." Sometimes I think that Mark left out an entire paragraph here. Jesus really said, if? What do you mean, if? I created you. I created your son. I created this world. I created the entire universe. If I am able, of course I am able. But more likely, Mark had the words correct, and Jesus didn't really go that far. He only says, if I am able, all things are possible for the one who believes. And we've just talked about believing, and I hope that we do believe. The father's response, though, is exactly how I feel. I do believe. Help my unbelief. I'm not sure how we change from happily knowing that God made the world and singing, "Jesus loves me, this I know," as children, to having doubt about what God can do when we become adults. There's some sort of change that we are transition that we go through, that we somehow lose that childlike faith, and somehow we need to find a way to recapture it. And as Jody says in his blog this morning, that even a little faith, along with God's power, will go a very long way. But life is all about change and transition as we go from one stage to another. And transition has been our theme of our presentations about the Hacienda this year. 2 weeks ago, we saw a video about Leonella and George as they transitioned from going to school at the Hacienda to going to school at a university. Last week, Glenn interviewed John, and as Lincoln said, it was good to get to see him and see how all this is going on in their lives, that he transitions not just from going to the Hacienda to a university, but to a university in the United States. Those are some major transitions, and things seem to be going smoothly for the young people involved in those changes. And I think that is something that we hope for ourselves or anyone close to us, that any transitions as we go from one stage of life to another goes well. But God is not always a God of smooth and easy transitions. When the Israelites entered the Promised Land, they had to fight for it. And not just one battle, many battles. The entire book of Joshua is filled with battle after battle. But there was another transition that was even more drastic than the Israelites taking the Promised Land. The transition from the Old Covenant to the New Covenant was a very violent transition. Matthew 27:50-52. And Jesus cried out again with a loud voice and yielded up his spirit. And behold, the veil of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. And the earth shook and the rocks were split. The tombs were opened and many bodies of the saints who had fallen asleep were raised. That was not a smooth or easy transition. It was not easy for Jesus, since Jesus had to suffer and die on the cross. It was not easy for God, since he had to be separated from Jesus, as all the my sins, your sins, the sins of the entire world were placed on Jesus. But God wanted us to know that the old covenant was finished. The veil was torn in two to remove it. Because of Jesus and the new covenant, we could now have direct communication with God. The normal person no longer had to go through a priest. We have all become priests. And because of this great gift, we are all not now a part of God's family. And each week, this communion we are about to partake of reminds us of the change from the old covenant and the sacrifice of the blood of bulls and goats to the change to the new covenant and the sacrifice and death of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Let's pray. Dear God, we're thankful that you thought enough of us, that you wanted us to be part of your family. We're thankful for Jesus dying on the cross. We're thankful for the body that he gave, the beatings that he took, the pain that he endured. And we're thankful for the gift of you giving his son, your son. And we thank you that you were willing to do all that because you wanted us to have a home with you. Help us to concentrate on these things and the fact that we are, and everyone who believes these things is a part of your family as we partake of this bread, which symbolizes Jesus' body. And it's through Jesus we pray. Amen.
Think about his love, think about his goodness, think about his grace that's brought us through. For as high as the heavens above, so great is the measure of our Father's love. Great
How can I forget His love? How can I forget His mercy? He satisfies my desires. Think about His love. Think about His goodness. Think about His grace that's brought us through. For as high as the heavens above, so great is the measure of our Father's love. Great is the measure of our Father's love.
Dear God, we come before You again, acknowledging that Your love is indeed very great, that there is no way to measure Your love. The measure of Your love by Christ's blood flowing out from His head, His hands, His feet, and His side shows how great Your love is, that You did not withhold Your only Son. We thank You for the blood that Jesus shed that cleanses us from the sins that we commit and continually commit, and we thank You that it continually washes them away. And we thank You for this fruit of the vine, which helps us to remember that and to help us remember the love that You and Jesus poured out on the cross. It's through Jesus we pray. Amen.
Think about His love. Think about His goodness. Think about His grace that's brought us through. For as high as the heavens above, so great is the measure of our Father's love. Great is the measure of our Father's love. Even when I'm strange.
Lord, the light of your love is shining in the midst of the darkness shining. Jesus, light of the world, shine upon us. Set us free by the truth you now bring us. Shine on me. Shine on me. Shine, Jesus, shine. Fill this land with the Father's glory. Blaze, Spirit, blaze. Set our hearts on fire. Flow, river, flow. Flood the nations with grace and mercy. Send forth your word, Lord, and let there be light. Lord, I come to your awesome presence from the shadows into your radiance. By the blood I may enter your brightness. Search me, try me, consume all my darkness. Shine on me. Shine.
This morning, one of the last things that anybody said to me was Coach Koyu. He said, "Blessed are the brief, for they shall be invited back." So, I've had several words of encouragement like that this morning, and so I just want to say I love you too. As we begin this morning, I want you to think about something. Have you ever had a conversation with someone and just walked away thinking that that person must think that the world revolves around them? Yeah. Or you have, haven't you? Or perhaps if their life was a soap opera, the title would be, "As the World Turns Around, Fill in the Blank." If I had time enough for a dramatic pause right here, you'd be filling in the blank. In fact, some of you probably already put my name in that blank. Truth be known, and no, Lynette, I was not looking at you. but it is true, isn't it, that you are the axis of your own little world, just like I am of mine. You know, no two of us share the same fears, hopes, loves. We don't have the same talents, interests, or no two of us even share the same faith experience. We're just at different places in our spiritual walk. We're different. It's just a totally different world. And your world includes your children, your grandchildren, your parents, your grandparents, your friends, your co-workers, the people in your neighborhood. And all these people are sort of in your orbit, just kind of going around you. And that's just normal. It's the way life is. I think where we run into problems is when we try to become the center of somebody else's world. It's okay to let things kind of revolve around us. That's the only perspective that we have in life. And I think that that is the key. And just understanding that there are other worlds around you and that they are just as important to our Creator. And in a sense, we're all these little worlds in God's solar system, and we're in orbit around Him. There are powerful lessons to be learned when we step back and we observe the amazing things that God is doing in the lives of others. Last year, we shared the remarkable story with you about a baby that was born and abandoned in a Kayambi shopping center. The mother was never found. We postulate that she was just a frightened teenager that gave birth, didn't know what to do, and just ran away. It was a child that was brought into this world with absolutely nothing, barely a roof over its head. It had no nurse to clean him up, not even a mother to hold him in her arms. Well, why should we care about this child's world? Well, Child Protective Services called Justin and Jonna Rieger, the people who run our children's home in Ecuador, and they told them about this child. And the baby, just to sort of set it up, was born just a couple of weeks before Christmas. And he was found by a policeman whose name was Angel, Angel. So an angel finds this baby just before Christmas. So what are they going to name him? They name him Angel Jesus, Angel Jesus. Well, Justin and Jonna gave it a lot of thought. Well, it wasn't not about whether or not to take him. Yeah, that was pretty obvious. Yes, we're going to take him, but how are we going to care for this child? Well, Jake and Tanya Wilson, who run our school, had been trying for years to have a baby of their own. They had been praying and praying. They'd set up a GoFundMe account that a lot of us had contributed to help to offset the expenses of in vitro fertilization. Well, after thinking this thing through, they talked to Jake and Tanya and said, would you take this child? And they said, yes, we would. So Angel Jesus came into their lives and filled a void in their hearts. And Jake and Tanya led with their hearts. They knew the odds were stacked against them, but they loved this child with every fiber of their beings. They risked brokenheartedness for a missional purpose because they loved this child. They loved AJ, or as we love to call him, Baby Jesus, with all their hearts. And they hoped, they sincerely hoped, that they would be able to adopt him, but they knew that this was going to be a difficult undertaking. Well, this past December, they were informed that another family had been selected to give him a forever home.
The story itself with him is so incredible just because you have a baby left and that, you know, here comes police, here comes everybody, and they want this baby to have a home. And so being able to take care of someone that is a famous story on the news here in the country, you know, is a little crazy in itself. I think God had a plan there for what AJ was going to do, because that you don't see that very often, and you know that there's something special about him and there's going to be something special for him.
I was thinking just when you asked to video yesterday, I spent some time thinking about just the overall experience, and you had mentioned something about the whole going through infertility and just kind of the timing of when AJ came into our lives. In that summer, we had lost our first pregnancy. And then 2 days before y'all called us, I got a negative test result from our second in vitro try. And I remember feeling very, very scared. During that time, I cried a lot before we went for our second in vitro procedure, because I was just so scared. Scared of being hurt, scared of pain, emotional and physical. And I feel like it probably robbed a lot of joy from me at the time. And then when we got AJ, it kind of reiterated at first some of that fear, because we knew that he could very well leave us. And I thought it was kind of ironic, all the feelings that I was going through, all of a sudden to be put in the situation where it should be a joyous and exciting time, but yet with the fear of possibly having to go through pain. And so I feel like God, through AJ, not only rescued AJ, but kind of rescued us and rescued me. Because despite the fact that there's always that fear, we had a lot of fun, and there was lots of love and lots of joy. And so I feel like it taught me to have faith. He taught me to have faith, that despite pain, despite our fears, to have that, to be open to love and to be open to whatever God has in store for us, and just to kind of face the fear and keep going forward. Mm-hmm. And so I think that was something that I came away with, and I will always be very grateful for. So, yeah.
I love what Tanya said towards the end of that video. They thought they were rescuing AJ, but God was using AJ to rescue them. You know, I don't pretend to understand how sovereignty works. Sovereignty is one of those theological terms that just difficult to understand, that God is engaged in our lives, that He is in control of this big picture. Yet at the same time, we have choices to make. It's those choices that cause us a lot of problems sometimes. But I believe in the sovereignty of God. I truly do. And I believe that God has a plan for each of our lives. You know, His plan doesn't necessarily include popularity or prosperity. And it won't necessarily be pretty, like what Clark was talking about before. And you know what? I doubt that it is possible for us to comprehend this sovereignty thing unless we understand that our purpose is not to be glorified, but to glorify Him. Got to remember that I am the created, He is the creator. He's the redeemer, I'm the redeemed. We understand this and it begins to come together, but we still acknowledge that we live in a broken world and people make choices, and those choices bring about consequences. AJ's circumstances had nothing to do with his own mistakes, but decisions made by a desperate mother. But you know what? We serve a caring Father, a good Father. A Father who can take broken things and make beautiful things out of them. He did in AJ's life and AJ's story. The psalmist said, "For you created my inmost being. You knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Your eyes saw my unformed body. All the days ordained for me were written in your book before one of them came to be." See, I think David here is trying to convey this understanding of the creator-created relationship. All the days ordained for me were written in your book. We do serve a God who is sovereign. And it is our stories sometimes have these beautiful moments, these moments of victory, but then there are moments when the victory comes out of a very dark place. I love these words from Corrie ten Boom. Corrie ten Boom wrote The Hiding Place. Her only crime was that she fed and rescued Jews who were being persecuted by the Nazis. And she wound up going to a German concentration camp herself. She said, if you look at the world, you will be distressed. She had a pretty distressing world to look at. If you look within, you will be depressed. The answers aren't in here. If you look at Christ, you will be at rest. AJ came into the lives of Jake and Tanya when they needed to be rescued. Paul said, but he said to me, my grace is sufficient for you. For my power is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, I will boast all the more gladly about my weaknesses so that Christ's power may rest on me. This little baby, born in a cold, nasty, and isolated corner of an outdoor shopping center, became an incredible blessing. I believe God's plan was at work in their lives, in AJ's life, and in the lives of the couple that you are about to meet. Our theme this year has been transitions. This is AJ's transition story.
People, kids can struggle with the concept of being wanted when they've known that they were abandoned or put up for adoption or whatever. Mm-hmm. But I hope that he knows how much he was loved and wanted, and not just by us, but by this couple who's adopted mm-hmm. them, right. adopted him. You could tell, and in just the couple days that we had, you know, interaction with them, how excited they were for him, and how much they've waited for him, and how much he's wanted by them. And mm-hmm. so I think that's what I hope for him to know, that he is wanted for and loved and cared for.
Mm-hmm.
So the first time they met Angel Jesus, he voices that there's no words. They have no words. They just are speechless. It was just a beautiful moment, and they can't express what it meant. So at the beginning of our marriage, we were trying to get pregnant. We kept trying and we kept trying, but we were unable. We visited several different doctor's offices and saw different specialists.
No logramos. Le llevamos al médico.
There are so many moments where my wife would just cry, and everything was just so, so much of a struggle. We tried different medicines, and we studied all of our options, and we had doctors doing research, trying to figure out what was going on. But then we began to realize we don't care if we are parents of a body, but we care that we're parents of their heart, of the child's heart. So you know that we are Catholic, and there was so many months there when it was just so much of a struggle, and it was so depressing, and I had been crying one day, and then I walked outside of our church, and I looked up in the sky, and I saw a figure of an angel. The statue of our angel outside the church looked like it was flying in the sky. And now that we've gone through this process, and I meet my son, and his name is Angel Jesus, and that can only be a thing of God. I'm so grateful to God for putting him in our life, and I know that he is from God only.
Jake and Tanya prayed for a child. They thought God's answer might be in a child of their hearts, but it was actually in a child of their bodies. Mila, didn't replace AG in their lives. Mila will become their biological child. At about the same time that it is really eerie how all of this works, Mila comes into their lives about the same time that they're having to let go of AJ. It's an incredible, incredible God story. They have a special place for AJ in their hearts. They always will. But Mila was the real answer to their years of prayer. You know, in a way, each of our lives is a soap opera with plenty of drama and with the occasional comic relief. And it's easy to get caught up in our world, so caught up in our worlds that we fail to see the incredible stories that are being lived out around us. We've seen today how the world turned in AJ's life and the blessing he was to so many. Even my life. See, I guess the world really does revolve around me if it comes right down to it. I'm going to miss him. He's a precious child. So this is what I hope you take away from this attempt at a lesson this morning. We serve an awesome God. He is sovereign, and he cares about all of our worlds. We should care about each other's worlds. And if he can use a newborn abandoned in a shopping mall in such a powerful way, what is he doing in your life? And what is he doing in mine? Let's open our eyes and let's look at the story that God is writing in each of our lives. Now, we realize that this project in Ecuador is new to many of you, and John Perry is going to come up and share just a few brief history of the work and share with you our funding priorities for the coming year. John.
Good morning. I want to take just a few minutes to give you a little backdrop for some of the things you've seen this morning. Give a little history, maybe if you're new to Twickenham, haven't heard a lot about the Hacienda of Hope. Kind of let you know where we've come from and especially where we're going here this year and what our goals are and what we'd like to do with our fundraising opportunity. The mission at the Hacienda of Hope is to provide a safe haven. You've heard a great example of that with AJ and John and so many others. It's to provide that safe haven for abandoned and neglected children of Ecuador. And beyond those physical needs, we're most importantly focused on serving these children in the name of Jesus and giving them an eternal hope. And as we do that, we also have opportunities to affect the community through education and through working in the community and with families. So if you go back with me to the year 2000, the Twickenham Missions Committee made a commitment to focus all of our mission efforts to a dedicated project, to a dedicated program. And as we did our research, we discovered two things. First, there's a small network of churches that are already working in Ecuador that would be very important to us in helping us get started. And second, that there was a real need to serve and to take care of neglected children. And that's when in God's perfect timing, he opened doors and challenged us with needs and opportunities that we'd never dreamed of. So 2001 was a year of many firsts. It was the first Sunday that we had a mission Sunday. And then it was also the first time that we hired a full-time missionary, William Proano, who came from the Quito School of Biblical Studies, worked for us with the local church and also helped us in our earliest preparations for a children's home. Likewise, 2001 was the year that our youth group took their first trip to Ecuador as a summer mission trip. And then most significantly, that was the year that we hired Jerry and Patricia Snyder as directors to work at the Hacienda of Hope. And that's when they began their 18 months of intense training and preparation and actually spending some time here with this congregation, becoming part of our family. And then in early 2003, the Snyders became our first feet on the ground. They relocated to Tabacundo, Ecuador. And then by the fall of 2003, they welcomed our first children to the Hacienda of Hope. Then as things progressed, we added more house parents in 2004, and we welcomed our first partner congregation, the Northridge Church out of Shawnee, Oklahoma. And then in 2005 marked an opportunity that we hadn't anticipated. See, in caring for 10 children, we also learned that the local school systems near Tabacundo, Ecuador, were very poor. And when I say poor, they were very low quality. In fact, it was really no education at all. And in many ways, it was in direct conflict with the things we were trying to achieve and things we were trying to provide for these children. So another door was opened, and we stepped through it into an opportunity to provide a quality education based on Christian principles, and it allowed us to provide an outreach to a community in reaching families by opening the Hacienda of Hope Christian Academy. Jerry and Pat were a special blessing as they brought unique talents and gifts to this mission. They led us through the purchase of a country hillside that would become the Hacienda of Hope campus. They helped set the vision for the infrastructure and the building of the casas. They even, and as we mentioned, they brought our first children to the Hacienda of Hope. And as the school need arose, one of the unexpected resources they brought was their youngest son, Justin, and his wife, Amanda. And they joined the staff in order to establish and grow the school from the foundation up. And when I say foundation, I mean we really started from just the basics. The campus was just a pasture on a mountainside. The school was to be converted from a dairy barn. And so we went through years of construction, a lot of construction, development of facilities and infrastructure. The campus now includes 4 casas, 2.5 apartments for interns. I say a half because one of them's just barely a closet, but there have been interns that actually live there. We've got a director's home at the school, and then just this past year, we completed a director's home at the Hacienda where Justin and Jonna live. The converted cattle barn is now a beautiful education facility and serves as an accredited school that teaches English as a second language, and which is a valuable skill for any of the children as they progress into their own independence and become self-supporting. Similarly, there are facilities for the various activities that are necessary for well-rounded children, likewise for community events and for a church that's self-sustaining. Then in 2013, as major construction wound down and the Snyders began their plans to return to the States, we recognized an acute need for specialized care for the children as we encountered the scars and troubles of abused children. God, in his perfect timing, led us to Justin and John Arieger. They were already located in Ecuador, running the neighboring camp that was operated by the Bellevue Church on property just adjacent to the Hacienda. And it just so happened that they were both trained in social work. They came with advanced degrees in counseling. They were even experienced at supervising a children's home. They knew the language, they knew the culture, and they were just what we needed at just the right time to provide the treatment and care and love that these children need. Likewise, Jake and Tanya came to us in 2013 as well. We discovered Jake and Tanya through the Operation Ecuador meeting, which is a workshop for congregations that meet here in the States that have work going on in Ecuador. Both Jake and Tanya were trained as educators, and they dropped their U.S. Careers to go into this mission field. They had a 2 to 3 year plan to come down there and join us, but timing was such that we needed them sooner, so they expedited those plans and joined us a year early, which is a big deal as they were working to sell a house and to make other arrangements and plans for support. So the Wilsons continue to grow the school and improve the education that is provided to these children. This is a great team that we have. We're so blessed to have such capable people on the ground providing the services that they do. And I would encourage you, as they come to visit from time to time, or if you have an interest in traveling, it's a great way to develop relationships with them and continue to encourage them. And finally, there's Kathy DeFrancis Jones, who's our very own from Twickenham. Kathy grew up here in our youth group. She discovered the Hacienda of Hope through travel with our youth team. And she fell in love with it immediately. She started down there as a short-term intern, moved on to a long-term internship, then actually married and started a family there in Ecuador. And she's a huge contributor. In fact, she's our longest tenured staff member down there at this time. She's worked both at the school and as a house parent, and she's most recently kept some of our older children, actually allowed them to live in her home as they transitioned out of high school. And then her husband, Jason, is trained in ministry at the Quito School of Biblical Studies, and he works locally there with the church and in the community. And of course, there are the children, each with their own stories, their own experiences. Some of those stories sad, some encouraging. They often bring happy faces, and they bring smiles and happy faces to those that visit them. But the key is, they're all filled with a message of hope and a knowledge that they belong to a God of truth that loves them no matter the circumstances. So going forward, today we're responsible for a full-time care of 32 children at the Hacienda of Hope. We have 235 children enrolled at the Hacienda of Hope Academy, and that's a record enrollment. So through this year, 2017, we'll continue to aid the children in their development and expand the school curriculum. Likewise, we'll continue to add children as needs arise. We'll continue to work with the Child Protection Services to assist and restore families, and we'll continue to build relationships in the community. We'll also continue to grow the infrastructure. We've recently started construction on a multi-purpose building at the school in order to accommodate student assemblies and productions. Likewise, we'll be adding more office space to the school that's so desperately needed. And as we saw with John Saviano last week, some of our kids are quickly approaching adulthood, so we're working personalized plans with each of them as they grow into their own independence, helping them to establish a trade or a vocation or pursue advanced education, or just helping them through other transitions. And it's worth noting that John came to us back in 2003 at the age of 5 in the first group of 10 children that we received. And he's literally grown up before our eyes. And the important thing is that he's done it knowing the name of Jesus. So in order to support these goals for 2017, as has been mentioned, next Sunday, March 5th, will be our annual Mission Sunday. We're asking Twickenham for gifts and pledges of $246,000 for the Hacienda of Hope Children's Home and Christian Academy. That's the amount that's needed to specifically provide child care and development, operations and maintenance of the facility, staffing, and support for Jason and Kathy DeFrancis as they work at the church in the school. Additional funds of over $500,000 will be provided by other mission partners and individuals to help meet the total program budget of $823,000. $400,000 of that is for the construction project that was mentioned. So we're asking this congregation to provide about 30% of the overall 2017 budget. We'll collect these gifts and pledges as part of the regular contribution next week. So the first $23,500 will go towards our regular Twickenham budget. So it's important we ask you to continue to honor your weekly commitments and give to the Hacienda of Hope above and beyond your regular contribution. And it's also worth noting that the funds for salaries for the Hacienda of Hope directors and the Academy directors comes out of that weekly Twickenham budget. So the plan is next Sunday, as part of our regular collection and worship, we'll collect gifts and pledge cards. You may have received a pledge card in the mail. It came with a letter. I actually received mine yesterday. If you didn't, it'll probably be in maybe your mailbox tomorrow. If you don't get one, please see myself or Steve Krieger or call the office, and we'll make sure you get one of these. If you can't be here next week, see Steve or me or somebody in the office, and we'll certainly coordinate to receive your pledge card at your convenience. You can make the gift all at once, or you can schedule it throughout the year. But we do need to know your commitment, so we ask you to plan and or to help us as we plan and operate accordingly. I should also mention there's a Hacienda of Hope Foundation. That's a 501c3 organization. So if you have company matching or know of some other corporation that would like to participate, we would more than be glad to accommodate and work with anyone interested. So your Twickenham Missions Committee understands that this is a significant request. We've prayerfully considered this need, and we understand that God has blessed this congregation richly and that He has always provided what we've needed in the past, and we're confident that He will continue to do so going forward. So two things I ask of you as I close. First, please prayerfully consider a generous gift. If you've given in the past, thank you. Thank you for your trust and your commitment to these children. Please consider how you can do more. And if you've not participated previously, please see how God can lead you to join in this wonderful mission with your financial support. I can tell you from firsthand experience, it'll be a blessing to you and to this program. And secondly, and just as important, I ask that you pray for these children that are in our care. If we believe anything about our own faith walks, then the words in these verses are true, and God is faithful to honor them. Please pray scripture over these children. Pray generously. Pray for Justin and Jana, Jake and Tanya. They give so much of themselves and their families and even their own livelihood to this mission and the children at the Hacienda of Hope. Pray that these children especially will personally come to know Jesus. Now, there's one thing I know about Twickenham is that it's a generous congregation. You've always exceeded our requests and always exceeded what we've asked for. And God, that's because God has blessed you and has blessed this church and has blessed this ministry. If you would, let's pray together over this offering. Father, we lift these children up to you. We lift this mission up to you. We give it to you as your work and not our own. Father, guide us, help us to make the decisions that are appropriate for these children, that they will have the best opportunity to know you, that they'll be able to walk with you and know your love and your presence. Thank you for Twickenham, for the giving heart and generosity that's been demonstrated so many times in the past. Challenge us, Lord, help us to know how to give, how to participate in this project. And Father, most of all, we thank you for the love of your son, Jesus, that transforms each one of our lives. Help us to recognize that and allow his overflow to touch those around us and to touch this mission at the Hacienda of Hope. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Shine, Jesus, shine. Fill this land with the Father's glory.
Us put this service together and participating this morning. And obviously, from all of the leadership, we do hope you'll prayerfully consider
this contribution coming up next week. A couple of quick details as we close. TCM, Children's Ministry, has a lock-in this Friday night, so make sure that you've got all your information for that from Amy. Also, continue to remember our Easter chorus, which is rehearsing on Wednesday nights at 6:30. If you'd like to join us in leading worship on Easter, we practice Wednesdays at 6:30. Also, next Sunday, wedding shower for Russell Mann and his fiancée, Christina Walker. Obviously, Russell is the son of Alan and Amy Mann. We have this morning focused on transitions, and there is another transition of which I wish to speak. It is a bittersweet transition. Nearly 6 years ago, Shelby and Jesse Corin came to our family, a young couple, to minister to our teens, and they've done a wonderful, wonderful job of that. They have had many transitions in those 6 years, including, of course, the addition of two beautiful little girls whom they love dearly, obviously. This past week, Shelby accepted a job with the Hendersonville Church of Christ in Hendersonville, Tennessee. What happened? What's the matter? Absolutely nothing, okay? They both come from very, very close families, and the Lord has put a burden on their heart over the last 4 or 5 months to return home and be closer to family. And as a leadership, we certainly bless that decision and wish them well in that. Shelby wrote this note. I'd like to share it with you. Nearly 6 years ago, Jesse and I made the move to Twickenham, and you welcomed us with great joy and love. A lot has happened with you since that. A lot has happened with you since. I can't even read. A lot has happened with you since that we are very thankful for. You have served alongside us and have prayed with us and for us, and you have taken great care of us. Specifically, we are thankful for parents who have let us be a part of their teenagers' lives by allowing them to be an active part of this youth ministry. We are thankful for elders who have trusted us, empowered us, and invested in us, giving us the opportunity to serve this church. We are thankful for a staff of men and women who have taught us, loved us, and fed us. They have laughed with us, cried with us, and have listened to a lot of our own babies crying. That is true. For months, when we first arrived here, we so desperately wanted our family to grow, and it was a struggle. Many of you prayed with and for us, and you rejoiced with us when we first learned of Ezra Kate. Almost 5 years and an Eli Reese later, we are and will always be incredibly thankful for the ways you have helped us to teach them about the God who so perfectly made them. Lastly, we are thankful for a group of teenagers who has been a great source of joy. It has been a blessing to us to watch you grow as young men and women, and that will not stop here. We cannot wait to see what God continues to do in and through your lives. Thank you for sharing so many memories with us. Thank you for loving and at times putting up with our girls. Thank you for always loving and respecting us. We will miss you more than you can know. We will forever be thankful for this place we have called home, and we will forever be thankful for the years we've been able to serve the kingdom of God together. To his name be all the glory, grace and peace, Shelby and Jesse. I know from personal experience that Shelby and Jesse made a difference in my son's lives. And I know that they will continue to make a difference in teenagers' lives wherever they are. And we are confident that God is preparing someone to come and take this spot and continue to make a difference in our teenagers' lives here. And so from the leadership, we say thanks and God's blessing. To the congregation, we want you to know that we will be putting a parent advisory and volunteer committee together to take care of present and future activities, and we will immediately begin to search out candidates for the position that will soon be open. They will be leaving early in April. Obviously, we will have more formal farewell at some point in the future, but we are thankful and grateful, and we ask God's blessing on you. Well, it's been a big day, a lot of things, but God continues to bless us and overwhelm us in so many different ways, and for that we are grateful. If you will stand, we're going to close in prayer. I hope you have a great week together. I hope that you will pray for their transition, and I hope that you will pray for the transition of the person that will come and take this place. And again, we hope that you'll pray about the Ecuador contribution next week. Thanks for being here. Have a great day. Eric.
Let's pray. Oh, Sovereign Father, we come to you giving you all praise, honor, and glory. We love you so much, and we're so thankful for being your children. God, we pray that you would increase our faith each and every day. Father, we pray that you would be with the Shepherd family and help us to all those in this congregation that are mourning, that we would mourn with those that are mourning and rejoice with those that are rejoicing, and just provide healing and comfort to those that need you. Father, we pray for your word that is sharper than any double-edged sword to be written on our hearts. Father, we pray for the courage and the ability and the strength to do your will here on earth as it is in heaven. God, we just pray specifically for Shelby and Jesse right now. We pray that you would give them blessing in their future. And Father, we pray that they would continue to be servants of yours in advancing the kingdom of God. And Father, we pray for the work at Ecuador. And Lord, we just pray that you would continue to bless the ministry on the ground there. And we're so thankful for our leaders, and just pray that you would be with the Riegers and the Wilsons. Pray that you'd be with the entire staff. And Father, we pray that you would continue to be with the children there, that they could grow in wisdom and favor and with you and with fellow mankind. And Father, we pray again for your advancement of the kingdom throughout everything in this entire world, God. And we pray that we could be your hands and feet of your son, Jesus. And it's in his perfect name we pray. Amen.